Welcome. I am extremely pleased to be here with Oskar Eustis.
Thank you.
Artistic director of the Public Theater. So, Oskar, you know, I was reading a few things about you, and I was caught by your own words. You said, I committed myself to playwrights, I committed myself to stories, and I committed myself to expanding the range of who gets to participate in the theater, who gets to see it, who gets to make it, whose stories get told, because the promise of America is that the culture belongs to everyone. How did you get there?
That's a great quote. I like the guy who said that. Listen, what's incredibly lucky about my situation is that, yes, that's my quote, but that could absolutely have been Joe Papp talking in 1954. The Public Theater stands for all of those things. And the great thing, the great opportunity I had when I got to be artistic director of the Public 13 years ago now, I guess, was that I got to go to a job that I completely believed in. There was not one inch of air between my personal beliefs and what the Public stood for. Partly that's because Joe Papp and I had a lot in common and a lot of the beliefs in common and all of that. But also there's sort of a trick in there. It's also because when I was 16 years old, I wandered into the Public Theater, and the Public Theater actually formed my idea of what a theater was supposed to be. And I spent basically the next 30 years of my life turning myself into the person who could run that theater. I mean, that was really, sometimes I even consciously thought it, though I never dreamed I'd actually get the job. So, you know, for me, it's a question of story. I started out in the 70s. I was downtown in Soho. I'd run away from home. You know, I was a countercultural guy. And back in the early 70s, you're all too young to remember this, but being a countercultural guy, there was sort of no distinction between sort of being politically progressive and sleeping with a lot of people and being a hippie and doing avant-garde art. It was all sort of the counterculture, right? So I was really drawn into the experimental theater scene, and I just sort of was passionate and committed to it. And for a number of years in the 70s, I was doing absolutely beautiful, incomprehensible theater. I was doing theater that had no story, that was visual, that was associative, that was like, if you watched it, you felt like incredibly lucky if you understood any of it. And I realized at a point in the late 1970s, I realized, oh my gosh, I had moved to Switzerland. I'd been hired there by the Swiss to make exotic American avant-garde work for them to appreciate, and they did appreciate it. And I felt so alienated. I realized I had this sort of dark night of the soul at the age of 20, which, I mean, as dark a night of the soul as you can have at the age of 20, where I suddenly realized that the work that I was making, I completely didn't believe in it. It was actually, I was making work, I wasn't conscious of this, but what I was actually trying to do was make work that was so complicated that my audience would feel intimidated by it, and they would feel like there was something wrong with them for not understanding it. So they would have to try to pretend so they, you know, which is, again, when you're 20 years old, you know, you're operating off a lot of unconscious impulses. And I was making this work out of fear. I was making this work to try to impress people. I was making this work to try to make me, to not be vulnerable, to try to make me seem incredibly cool, not to actually communicate. And I cried for a long time, and then I moved back to the United States. And what I realized is that I had to really just rip up how I'd been making work. And for me, story was key to that. Because the thing about stories are the great equalizer. And I think we've all experienced this in our lives, and I hope you've experienced it in the theater, that, you know, I experience it with Shakespeare all the time. Kids can enjoy Shakespeare just because they're following the story, just because what happens next to Romeo and Juliet, what happens next. Audiences in prison who have no education can follow Shakespeare just by following the story. They don't understand 90% of the words. They don't understand all the poetry. And God knows they couldn't unpack the poetic illusions of the Scottish play. But they can understand a guy who wants to be king so bad that he'll do anything to do it. And that's what stories do for us. They equalize everybody. And it's one of the things that I'm convinced make Shakespeare the greatest writer in the history of the English language and possibly in the history of the world. Because he was a beautiful poet, and he would have been a beautiful poet without the theater. We have the sonnets to prove that. His writing ability, the theater can't take credit for. Aristotle said, the gift for metaphor is the one thing that cannot be taught to a writer. And Shakespeare had that in extraordinary fashion. But then he was also a working professional. And, you know, he got some patronage for the sonnets, but he needed to actually make a living, and he needed to make a theater. And because of the particular nature of England in the 16th century and the Tudor compromise under Elizabeth, you had a situation where suddenly, not only did you not have to do religious theater, which is really the only thing that had existed for centuries before that, but because Elizabeth was so intent on damping down the war between Catholics and Protestants, it was illegal to do religious theater. You were not allowed to treat religious subjects on stage. So suddenly, by this weird back door, theater's being told, you have to do secular theater. And by the way, we're also going to now allow everybody to watch it at the same time. So Shakespeare, you're going to build the Globe, and you're going to be in a 2,000-seat theater, and you're going to have to write work that appeals at the same time to illiterate groundlings, to Oxford and Cambridge graduates, to the Queen herself, and to the aristocracy. Go. Write a show that they all like. And what Shakespeare discovers is that, you know, what all of us in the theater discover, you can't do like, okay, this part is for the illiterate groundlings, and then this part is for, because nobody will stay with you. You have to take an audience at the same time through the story. So you have to get something that everybody will be enjoying all the time, although there may be different parts that they have as favorites. And so Shakespeare expands the range of what he's doing so that he can speak to the most democratic audience that had existed in the Western world since the Greeks, and speak to all of them at once. And then here's the beautiful trick of it, and this is where the politics of it come in, is in order to speak to them all at once, what he's implicitly doing is saying, and I'm going to mirror back to you what you all have in common with each other, because I can't keep you all watching the same story if I'm not actually drawing out from you that you have more in common with each other than you think, illiterate groundlings and Cambridge graduates. You have more in common than you think, merchants and aristocracy. And by doing that, you can see that Shakespeare's not just doing writing great theater, he's actually forging this idea of what it means to be English. That the English, still to this day, their national identity is sort of created by what Shakespeare does. And boy, what an inspiring example that is. That was sort of, I just took a breath because I didn't know what to say next while I was
That was amazing. You know, that is much more than I expected when I asked that question.
Yeah, I know.
Thank
sorry.
You. That's amazing.
More is more.
So, you know, the other thing, you know, I that struck me in reading about you, this, again, written by you, so, and this related to, I guess you were watching an avant-garde performance in the streets of Ann Arbor, and it says, one evening in May 1975, I stood outside a bank in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and I lit every dollar in my wallet on fire. As the bills burned, I held them up to the sky, tears streaming down my face. Now, as I read that, I think, well, the public subsists on money, and it subsists on the donations of corporate entities. And when did you make the transition from burning the money to accepting to live with it?
You know, it's actually interesting because that was sort of, in a way, precisely the point of that story, is that I was, this was a performance piece that the Living Theater was doing on the streets of Ann Arbor in 1975, protesting the military-industrial complex. And so they went around to different iconic sites and did ritual gestures, you know, to the draft board and the ROTC and the bank. And at the bank, what they did was burn Monopoly money as a symbol of protest. But I, like, burned all the real money I had. And probably the real enlightenment was the next morning when I had to call my parents to get car fare to come back home. But, you know, it was realizing that at the, for me, that at the same time I was protesting a lot of what our country was doing, and certainly the war, which was not yet over, was still very much at the heart of that, but that I was also going to have to live within the country. What became important to me is realizing that all of whatever ideals I had, whatever utopian visions I had, whatever I believed, were useless if I couldn't put into practice things that I thought actually made people's lives better right now, actually changed people's lives for the better. And it's one of the things I think I'm privileged to do in the theater, because the big job in the theater is not about changing anybody's mind about what they believe politically or protest. The big job is to draw people into the conversation and say, this is a conversation that all of us should be in. This is something we should all be talking about. Hamilton is a perfect example of that. It's expanding who gets to tell the story, who gets to feel like they're at the center of the story, who, you know, we use these terms in theater that have passed into common phraseology to be put somebody center stage, to put the spotlight on somebody. That's what we actually do every night. That's what we, and metaphorically, we're trying to do it too, to say to everybody that the promise of America is that we're all in this together, that this gets to be everybody's story, that we're stronger when we think of ourselves as united, not when we think of ourselves as separate. And that, to my mind, ends up being a much more effective intervention than, say, burning my money in front of a bank, which, let's face it, didn't really improve anybody's life.
So, you know, I know that we'll get to your work at the Public, but, you know, I was very embarrassed to learn, which I think I should have known, that while you were working, so two jobs prior to the Public at the Eureka Theater, you gave Tony Kushner commission to write a second play, which turned out to be Angels in America. You know, I'd love to hear just the story about that, and also the fact that at the towards as it started, you know, rising, you directed it and then handed it over to George Wolfe, who himself was the artistic director of the Public that you took over from.
Right. Yeah, handed it over is a very polite way of saying it. It was a very calamitous move, and I'll talk a little about that. But let me talk about the show first, because I met Tony in 1985, and he was still a student at NYU, and I saw a first staged reading of a play called Bright Room, Cold Day. And it was one of those moments that, you know, we live for in my field, which is before we hit intermission, I knew I was in the presence of a great writer, and I knew I was in the presence of a great writer who cared about the things I cared about. It was just, it was extraordinary. And we became close friends immediately, and he remains my best friend. We had a little trouble during that handoff to George, but we've remained, you know, very, very close for 33 years. And I directed his first professional production, which was of Bright Room. Before we even done, we knew we wanted to do a play together. And you're going to have to stop me because this is getting a little more into the sausage making.
Go.
So it could be boring. But so the I said, we want to commission you to write a play. And by the way, the National Endowment for the Arts has a commissioning program, so we can apply for a grant from the federal government to commission you for a play. This was just before the big culture wars with Jesse Helms, if any of you are old enough to remember this. And 2 years later, it became illegal for the NEA to give grants to individual artists. So we slipped in under the wire, and I feel duty-bound to say that Angels in America was commissioned by a grant from the government of the United States. But we had to write a grant proposal, and he wanted to write a play, and we said, okay, well, what are we gonna put in the proposal? He said, I have a great title, Angels in America. I said, right on. We wrote it out, we had no idea. And then we started talking about what it should be about. And the only thing that we're absolutely sure of is that it needed to be about the AIDS crisis, because we were in San Francisco, Tony was in New York. It was 1986. It felt at times like everybody I knew was dying. This was before even AZT. There was no treatment. It was terminal. It was, I know some of you remember how terrifying that period of time was. So we knew we were going to do that. And Tony was sure that Roy Cohn should be a central figure. And the reason he was sure of that is partly because Roy Cohn is an unbelievable character, unbelievable figure, but also because he had recently died, and there had been an obituary in The Nation, which was shocking, because The Nation, a progressive left-wing rag, wrote this obituary for Roy Cohn that was just gloating in its homophobia. I mean, it was just disgusting the way that people who called themselves progressive gave themselves permission to despise Roy. We could despise him for his hypocrisy, but despise him because he was gay. And during this period, Tony, the AIDS quilt had its first big exhibition in San Francisco, and Tony and I, it was laid out in the Moscone Center, it was overwhelming. Tony walked through it, and we discovered there was a panel on the AIDS quilt for Roy Cohn. And it was a black panel, I don't know who made it, and it just said, Roy Marcus Cohn, bully, traitor, victim. And Tony said, if I can write something half as dialectical as that, I'll have a great character. And he did indeed write a great character, and if any of you haven't had a chance to see Nathan Lane do it Uptown right now, it's really worth it. It's an astonishing performance. So we worked on that play then for 6 years and developed it and grew up. I mean, I was, 28 when we started, and I was 107 when we finished in dog years. And it was a beautiful process, and it was the first time that I experienced what I've been fortunate enough to experience once or twice since, of a play opening and just hitting the national nerve. You could just feel the you couldn't contain it in the theater. The reverberations just immediately went out across the country. And we premiered it years later in 1992, and it was landing just at the moment that actually everything was starting to change about what it meant to be gay in America. And you could feel that the play wasn't causing that, but the play was part of that. The play was the sort of high culture expression of that in a way that just felt thrilling.
Did the length intimidate you?
The length was actually, the first discussion that Tony and I really had about the length of Angels in America was a turning point in my career. Because at the beginning of that discussion, I was the senior guy who was so much more established and successful than Tony, and I could tell Tony what to do. By the end of that argument, which Tony won, insisting that it could be two evening long, I was the guy who carries Tony Kushner's bags, and I've remained so ever since, because he came to me. If there's something more, but what we knew about Bright Room, his first play, it had been a success d'esteem. It was smart, it was brilliant, it was beautiful, but really it hadn't landed. Nobody really loved it. And my diagnosis was very simple, that Tony had mastered everything about playwriting except the concept of dramatic action or reversal, which translates in simpler terms into the fact that people have to change, that drama is the story of people changing. And if people don't change, it can be a very interesting story, but it's not fundamentally dramatic. Tony totally agreed. I made him read the Poetics again. We talked about it. See, I was still the older brother then. We talked about it, and he set out to go, okay, Angels of America, my characters are going to change. And after about a year of working on it, he came to me and said, Oscar, I can't get these characters to change fast enough. And I chuckled patronizingly and explained to him, oh, that's just because you're being self-indulgent, and you overwrite anything, and you're afraid to kind of. And he said, no, I think it should be two evenings long. And I laughed and said, of course we can't do that, Tony. And again, 2 weeks later, he'd won that argument. And what he did was just brilliant. And again, Hamilton's probably a little more entertaining than Angels, but Angels, go see it if you can. What he did is he took that difficulty in making his characters change, which at the beginning was a purely formal difficulty. He knew he had to do that to make a drama happen. And he made it into the content of the show. The fundamental content of Angels in America is how incredibly difficult it is to change, how painful it is, how slow it is, how much it feels like dying, and how actually it's the opposite of dying. It's what living requires. And by doing that, he made this play that, again, just, I mean, it's played all over the world. And now this 25th anniversary production of it sort of, you know, my 30-year-old self is looking back going, what the heck? Because it's now really part of the canon. It's really, you know, one of the great plays that we have, and I'm pretty happy about that.
So now transitioning to the public.
Yeah.
And you said you wonder when you were 16. Was this a time that you auditioned or you just visited?
God, you want to bring up my most humiliating moments. Because I started by visiting. I started by just going to, and I followed an experimental theater company into the public. I loved them. They were in residence, and I just looked around, and I was like one of those baby ducklings that Conrad Lorenz, you know, a log floats by them, and they decide the log is their mother, and I just decided that the public was the greatest theater on earth. But yes, I was still an actor at that point, Pablo, and yes, I did audition for Joe Papp. And yes, it was one of the most humiliating moments of my life. I was 17 years old. I came in and I auditioned for Joe. And literally, he let me go on for 20 minutes. He just sat there staring at me, flop sweat just pouring down my face. I knew I was doing terribly. I was doing so terribly. And at the end of it, he was not cruel, but slightly dismissive. And I walked out of the room and I say, I am never doing that again. And I decided to become a director on the spot. And it was actually a great gift because I wasn't that good an actor, but also because the whole experience taught me I don't have the temperament to be an actor. I don't have the sturdy sense of self and relaxation that would allow me to be judged that way every time I wanted to work. I just couldn't do it. And by the way, it's the hardest thing about being an actor is the temperament for putting up with the life of an actor, the temperament for putting up with the lack of power of an actor. That's actually more important than talent, is can you actually be satisfied being that much in other people's power all the time? And some people can, and I admire them, but I couldn't, so I became a director.
And were you intimidated to follow the great man's footsteps?
Oh God, yes, that was Joe Papp. Joe, you know, I still believe this. Obviously, I love the public theater, but Joe Papp is arguably the most important man in 20th century American theater. He did more to affect our idea of what the theater should be, to create an aspiration for the nonprofit theater, to demonstrate. I mean, and Chorus Line started at the public and then moved uptown and became sort of the first time that a nonprofit theater had this huge commercial hit. And, you know, what Joe did with the money over the next 20 years was probably not the wisest choice, and we're trying to be smarter about it. But he still, one of the things that he did that I just find so breathtaking is that he was a fiercely committed artist who was committed to including everybody, to bringing in dispossessed and despised communities and giving them voice, going out and performing for the people. The idealistic mission of the theater was central to him, but he also never forgot he was in show business and that creating great entertaining shows that everybody wanted to see was not a contradiction, that those two missions actually belonged together, that when you went into the nonprofit theater, you weren't turning your collar on backwards and joining a monastery. You were actually saying, no, we can make work that is as popular as anybody, but it's going to be popular with content to it. It's going to be popular not simply to be popular, but to actually carry meaning, which, you know, of course, a show like Chorus Line or venture to say now a show like Hamilton is proof of. And that's, you know, nobody had thought that way before Joe.
And between those two, I'm going to mention Passing Strange, Here Lies Love, and Fun Home. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to use, again, your words for Fun Home. Biggest hit musical of all time about a lesbian cartoonist whose gay father kills himself. I will add, this is my own edit, based on a graphic novel.
Exactly.
All right. So how do you go from graphic novel, everything you said, into... tell us about... How does it goes from the idea to what we all saw.
Here's the beautiful thing about Fun Home and about being able to work in Fun Home with the public. We never thought it would be hugely popular. We all, right to the end, we thought, oh, we're making a show that we're gonna love. This is gonna be, it's gonna be nice for our audience. We'll run it for maybe 7 weeks in a 300-seat theater. It'll be great. It never, and we didn't, and it's not just because we were dumb, although we may be, but it's because it's not our job to try and turn it into a Broadway hit. It's our job to try and make it the best version of itself it could be. And we felt like we knew there was a great story in there, and it was about how do you work it to bring it out. And I, ultimately for me, the heart of Fun Home is it's a story about how different it is to be gay in America in Allison's father's generation and in her generation, that she has possibilities that he never could, and understanding her coming to understand that, that Hilton Auld's, the critic for The New Yorker, actually had this beautiful formulation. As he said, you know, Alison Bechdel, at the end of her journey, became the gay young man her father could never be. Oh. And it's actually, it's a beautiful formulation, it's actually true. So figuring that out and figuring out how do you tell that story was so fun and so hard. It was the opposite of Hamilton. You know, Lin-Manuel kind of like touched the earth and this oil gusher came out. He describes himself occasionally as a mosquito who landed a vein on an elephant. You know, and you could feel it. It was just pouring out. We worked really hard on it, but right from the beginning, it was there. Fun Home was carpentry. Fun Home was like, this doesn't work. Let's try to make this. Lisa Cron and Janine Tesori wrote 17 different opening numbers. And if you, you probably don't know how hard it is to write a number for a show and an opening number for a show. That's crazy. But it was so fun to try and tackle it. And at a certain point, the great thing about working on material like that is you get to a point where you go, oh, this isn't like anymore trying to imitate anything. This isn't like any other musical. We're now so deep into this. This is its own thing, and we're just trying to let it become itself. And then we put it in front of the world and go, oh my gosh, way more people are responding than we thought would. And then, oh my gosh, way more people are responding. And then, oh my God, we're moving it to Broadway. And we've won the tone. I mean, it was crazy to keep two wheels. And, you know, as Lisa Cron said on closing night at the Public, she said, many people have told me this is bigger than a lesbian musical. I've decided it's exactly the size of a lesbian musical. And, you know, what it did, in a way, was exactly what Angels had done 25 years earlier for gay men, which is it has lesbian characters who are openly and in a complicated and unashamed way lesbian, who are speaking not only their story, but speaking everyone's story, who say, we get to stand in for everybody, not just for ourselves. And that's a huge movement in the culture. It happened, you know, although Arthur Miller didn't say the Lohman family was Jewish, if you listen to Attention Must Be Paid, that's not Anglo-Saxon. The Lohman family was Jewish, and what Arthur Miller was saying is this Jewish family can not only talk about the Jewish experience, it can talk about the American experience. It's what August Wilson was doing in his great history cycle, not just saying this is black history, but these are black Americans who can stand at the center of the 20th century in America. And it's what Lisa and Janine were doing with the lesbian experience and Alison Bechdel in Fun Home. Because that's, you know, and it's really that, it's about the politics again. That's how people's minds change.
The not power by, of art.
Exactly, and it's not by arguing with them and telling them, you need to think differently about gay people. It's by giving them experience where at the end of an hour and a half, they've just spent an hour and a half totally identifying with gay people. That's an experience that you can't get out of your skin. That's an experience where actually you're changing hearts before
through
you change minds.
Through the story. So the story of Hamilton is pretty well known. You know, you watched the video of his performance at the White House and then pursued him, heckled him, you know, to turn that song into a musical, which at least in his first interactions with you wasn't what he preferred to have in mind for it.
Yeah, although Lynn said to me, I saw the tape of him performing the first song, which is all that existed, in front of the President of the United States in 2009, April 2009. And Obama has since said on several occasions that he thinks he deserves a Tony because it was really developed at the White House. I instantly, it was one of those moments like when I saw Tony's first play, I just went, oh, genius, let's make this happen. And for 3 years, Lynn kept telling me, no, it's not a musical. It's a concept album. I'm just writing a bunch of songs, we're gonna do an album, and then maybe like Jesus Christ Superstar, once the album is released, we'll make a show out of it. I didn't know Lynn that well at the time, but now in retrospect, it's quite clear to me he was doing two things. One, the sometimes difficult job of backing me off, which when I'm pursuing an artist can get hard. But second, he was also buying himself permission to not have to worry about writing a book of a musical. Because and now it's easy to forget, he'd never done that before. That he had tried to write the book for his first musical, In the Heights, it had failed, and he had to bring in a book writer, Kiara Hudas, to actually do the book. So he needed to relieve himself of that pressure while he was composing the songs. And about 2.5 years later, there was a little workshop up at Jazz at Lincoln Center where Lin-Manuel was showcasing his work. And the second part of it was a sing-through of most of the first act of Hamilton. And at that point, it was unavoidable that it was a musical. He couldn't pretend it wasn't. And so then, fortunately, he thought the public was a good place to work on it. And we worked on it for the next 2.5 years. And I think the public did turn out to be a good place to work on it. And I just feel blessed. I thought after Angels, I would never go through an experience an artistic experience as transformative as that, and I was wrong. Hamilton is, you know, you can't compare the two of them, but in terms of the impact it's had on the world, it's just extraordinary to be able to be part of that.
So, you know, I'm very familiar with the musical itself. I've watched it at the Public a few times before I went to Broadway. Of all of those things, you know, the one actually that sticks in my mind is the casting call.
Yeah.
You know, Hamilton set out to specifically target a diverse cast.
That's
and,
right.
You know, whereas I believe in anybody can play any part, the notion of targeting specifically,
yeah.
You know, I figured was, I'd like to know, like, how was that discussed? You know, how what were your thoughts around that?
What was so brilliant about Hamilton is it, you know, we had done colorblind casting for 60 years, you know, in other words, James Earl Jones plays King Lear and Jill Clayburgh plays Cordelia and nobody cares. So that was something that Joe pioneered. We'd done color specific casting for a lot of things where we're deliberately casting people of color in roles reserved for white people in order to make a specific point within the play. But Hamilton said, wait a minute, we don't care what race any particular role is. We're not saying that people's race is the criteria. What we are saying is America belongs to immigrants. And how do you say that? You cast it with immigrants and the descendants of immigrants. That's what so it's a meta message to the casting. And there's a moment right in the beginning of that opening number where the entire cast just walks downstage and stands in a line. And it's very deliberately, that's not actually a choreographic necessity for that song. That's a choreographic introduction to the show and saying, look at us, we are telling the story of America. And that's right, only a couple of us are white people. And it's a thrilling moment because it's not conscious. In the audience, I don't think you go, oh my gosh, they're making the statement, this, but you feel it in the audience. You feel the sense of this is saying the story of America is ours to tell. It's not just your property, it's our property. And what shocked me is when we went to London, I thought, well, that won't happen. And damn it, the same thing happened. First preview of Hamilton London, the cast is entirely diverse, entirely Brits, but when that cast stepped forward in that same move on the London stage, you could feel the London audience feeling the same thrill. Even though they're talking about America, you could see that the audience was saying, this is us. This is England. There, the vibrancy and voraciousness of their response was the same as we got in America. And it's a beautiful thing to feel that that particular idea is not just confined to our own national story. We're actually, hopefully, part of the world struggling with what we're struggling with right now, which is who is us, and can we keep going if we divide the world into an us or them, or is that actually going to kill us, and we have to figure out some way to think of everybody being part of the story.
So Oskar, you know, to paraphrase you slightly, I am glad to be a New Yorker, and in part it is because you've come into contact with who you are and what you do. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.